Hi, welcome to Insane Curiosity. Are you having a good day? We hope so. Fasten your seatbelt because today we want to talk about a planet. Oh no, don't worry. We are not talking about a planet in our solar system. We will be talking about an exoplanet. Its name is WASP-189b. The question is, why are we going to talk about it? What's special about WASP-189b? WASP-189b is one of the most highly irradiated planets known thus far, with a dayside equilibrium temperature of 3400 degrees Kelvin. This tells us that WASP-189b is bright. Actually, it's very bright. It could be brighter than some stars. In this video, we will tell you how this discovery was made, which instruments and techniques were used to analyze its characteristics. Also keep in mind that we already knew WASP-189b, but we didn't know it so well. It's like when a new person comes into your life and you find him to be nice. So you think something like, maybe I should ask him out again. We could spend some great time together, and then you ask him out again. And it turns out he was way more interesting than you could have thought. Follow us on this journey somewhere 325 light years away from the sun. We are sure you will be amazed by the things you will learn in this video. Let's go. The one about WASP-189b isn't a new discovery. As we've already said, we detected it in 2018 orbiting around the A-type star WASP-189 at a distance of about 99 parsecs. But the CHEOPS mission made its debut trying to obtain some further pieces of information about this planet. In fact, the European Space Agency's Characterizing Exoplanet Satellite, CHEOPS, space telescope, reached space in December of 2019, achieving a sun-synchronous orbit some 700 kilometers up. The instrument has begun its observations of stars near the sun that are already known to have planetary companions. The idea is to use the 30-centimeter optical telescope to constrain radius information for these worlds, previously identified in transit and radial velocity studies. Transiting planets are particularly useful here because tightening up their radius measurements means we get a better idea of their density, factoring in mass estimates provided by subsequent radial velocity follow-ups. It was great to see this 30-centimeter telescope. Yes, it's a tiny and cute one, already at work, with measurements of the giant planet WASP-189b showing us a world that is one of the hottest known, with a likely temperature around 3400 degrees Celsius. By comparison, the surface temperature of the Sun is about 6000 degrees Celsius, while smaller M-dwarfs can have temperatures below that of this incendiary planet. A planet hotter than some main sequence stars, so no place for life. It's a hostile world. But just because it can't host life as we know it, it doesn't mean that it's a boring planet. Of course, you can't have ice cream, but there is so much more than this. There are a lot of things that could be interesting about WASP-189b. For example, in this case, the planet is an extreme one because it has a highly inclined orbit. In fact, it was detected by studying both transit and occultation as the planet moves behind the star. The transit method consists of regularly measuring the luminosity of a star in order to detect the periodic decrease in luminosity associated with the transit of an exoplanet. The transit happens when a planet passes in front of its star. On the other hand, when the planet passes behind the star, it is called an eclipse. The effect measured during transit is quite small. For a star the size of the Sun, the transit of a Jupiter-sized planet will cause a decrease in the apparent luminosity of about 1%, while this decrease will be of about 0.001% for a planet the size of the Earth. This method makes it possible to determine the radius of the planet as well as its period of revolution. Furthermore, if the planet has already been detected using the radial velocity method, then its mass is known and it is possible to obtain a value for the bulk density of the planet. The transit method as such does not allow a detailed study of the characteristics of the planet. However, the study of the atmospheres of planets discovered by the transit method can be carried out by CHEOPS studies. And in fact, that's what astronomers did. They found that WASP-189b's orbit is so inclined that it passes just near to the poles of the star. Repeated observation by CHEOPS let us understand more about this planet. For example, because the exoplanet WASP-189b is so close to its star, its dayside is so bright that we can even measure the missing light when the planet passes behind its star. This is called an occultation. We have observed several such occultations of WASP-189b with CHEOPS. It appears that the planet does not reflect a lot of starlight. Instead, most of the starlight gets absorbed by the planet, heating it up and making it shine. As Monica Lendl, University of Geneva, said, WASP-189b is one of the most highly irradiated planets known thus far, with a dayside equilibrium temperature of 3400 Kelvin. Can you imagine it? It completes an orbit in 2.7 days, placing it closer in temperature to ultra-short-period planets orbiting F and G stars. As such, this object allows us to comparatively probe the impact of different stellar spectral energy distributions and, in particular, strong short-wavelength irradiation on planetary atmospheres. As it is orbiting around an A-type star, the system is also relatively young, 730 million years, providing us with a window into the atmospheric evolution of close in-gas giants. So we are facing a system that has a fraction of the age of our solar system, which is old, about 4.5 billion years. This lets us see some of the formation processes behind planetary systems, different from our solar system. Also, we can test our models to see if we are on the right road. All of this has been made possible by CHEOPS. The beauty behind this kind of discoveries is that every step is a small piece of the puzzle of exoplanets, their evolution, and in general, the evolution of the universe. We found that WASP-189b's diameter is about 224,000 kilometers. That is 1.6 times bigger than the diameter of Jupiter. It's a huge planet. One of the advantages to having a planet so big and so hot is that the clouds in the atmosphere are very expanded. And in the future, with the right instruments, we could observe its atmosphere to see better the light that comes from the star and passes through it, reaching us. In this way, we could have a better understanding of the gases that make up WASP-189b's atmosphere. A hypothesis for the formation of WASP-189b might be that it formed from its own separate collapsing disk at the same time as the parent star collapsed. So it begins already with an inclined orbit, so it didn't have to form in the protoplanetary disk around the equator of the star like most exoplanetary systems in a flat disk. Gas giants might form earlier than rocky planets. So CHEOPS has given us a tighter look at WASP-189b. Obviously useful information, but what this paper really demonstrates is the power of the space observatory at detecting extremely shallow signals, as it is necessary to gauge brightness variations between pole and equator in stars like the primary here. From this, we learn about the planet's unusual polar orbit. We can look forward to measurements of much cooler planets at similarly high levels of precision. The best-case scenarios discussed in the paper will be objects for which CHEOPS can make phase curve studies that reveal information on the distribution of clouds in planetary atmospheres. The resulting transit and occultation catalog will be large and instructive. We hope you are enjoying this video, but before finding out more about WASP-189b and exoplanets, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. We would like to conclude this video with an interesting comment from Henry Cordova. My subjective impression from reading the last few entries here is that exoplanets and their stellar systems are extremely varied. No two are alike, and even in our solar system, the satellites seem all different, both in properties, type, and origin. Galaxies, clusters, stars, and all other astronomical objects seem to fall into families, types, and classes. Sure, there are outliers and rogues, weirdos, and exceptions, but they are mostly classifiable into finite and recognizable taxa. But the retinue of objects orbiting stars all seems to be composed of totally unique creatures. At first, I feared that extrasolar planets would be few and far between, that smooth, well-ordered systems like our own would be hard to find. But at least the ones we did locate would fall into some scheme that could be classified, organized, fitted into some predictable scheme of evolution. Instead, what we find is that planets are ubiquitous, but there doesn't seem to be some process that generates them according to any predictable plan. Like the satellites in our own solar system, no two seem to be alike, and they resist falling into well-behaved families and groups. The plurality of worlds around other stars suggests they are common throughout the universe, but that Earth-like worlds and stable planetary systems may well be the exception, not the rule. The limitations of our technology and the unforgiving influence of selection effects may be conspiring together to not only show us the oddballs. Perhaps Earth-like worlds around stable stars are common. We just haven't seen any due to our crude investigative methods. But we have to keep in mind one thing. We are far away from having a classification for exoplanets like the one we built for stars. We are going to need a lot of observations before we can build a good statistic for them. This is why CHEOPS and similar missions are so important for us these days. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you like it? What do you think about WASP-189b? Can you imagine yourself in a sci-fi scenario on this planet? Let us know in the comment below. Free your imagination. See you next time on the channel.